praise the Lord, my brothers and sisters. How many know that sometimes music and songs will bless us and encourage us as we go through the storm? So this song, I pray, will bless you as you hear it repetitiously. Join in and give God praise. Amen. Come on. Hey.
Yeah.
praise the Lord. Bless his holy name. Surely goodness and surely mercy shall be with us forever. Right beside us, he says. Hallelujah. Welcome, my brothers and sisters, to Purpose for Life Ministries once again. We're always excited about serving the Lord and being a blessing to the people of God. And so we pray you receive this entire service to honor glory, to honor God, and to give him glory, but also to be built up and strengthened up in the Lord. Amen? Amen. So what do we do here in this house? We always declare something. And you all by now know what it is. We go, Jesus is Lord. And that God is great and greatly to be praised. Amen?
Amen.
Hallelujah. And listen, one of the things that I like to say before we do our affirmations is, I like to just say this. How many believe that there's life and death in the power of the tongue? That what we speak out of our mouths, what we believe by faith, amen, that we shall have. Because the things that we're going to do in our affirmations, you all know, is scripture. And that is in line with God's will. So, this is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day we're going to be a blessing to God and to others. This is the day we're going to be victorious over anything that the world or the devil brings our way. This is the day we're going to be fruitful and effective in everything that we put our hands to do. This is the day we're going to have peace that the world didn't give us and the world can't take it away. This is the day we're going to be healthy from the top of our heads to the soles of our feet. Come on now.
And finally,
this is the day we're going to let go and let God have his way. Amen. Come on, give God praise. Hallelujah. Wherever you are, let's just take a moment and glorify him and exalt his name. I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. And I pray in yours as well. Amen. So again, thank you for tuning in, whosoever will, that is doing this right now. I'm Pastor Don. That was my lovely wife, Sister Yvonne. And we just love serving God. We love being a blessing to the people of God, but because we know that as we are a blessing to anyone, we're also a blessing to God. Amen?
Amen.
And so let's get into the word. You heard me say, let go and let God have his way. Amen? You heard me say, there's life and death in the power of the tongue and what we believe and what we say out of our mouths. We shall have by faith and obedience because it's in line with God's will if we operate that way. And the reason I say all of that is because of where we're going today. I'm going to tell you right now, today is a message to challenge you to grow a little higher, to come up a little higher, to believe a little bit more about who God is, and then operate by faith and activate your faith. Amen? So today, turn with me, if you would, to Matthew, the Gospel according to Matthew chapter 19. We're going to read verses 16 through 26. That's the Gospel according to Matthew chapter 19, verses 16 through 26. And I will be reading from the New King James Version. Beginning in verse 16, it reads like this. Now behold, one came and said to him, good teacher, what good thing shall I do that I may have eternal life? So he said to him, Jesus did, why do you call me good? No one is good but one, that is, God. But if you want to enter into life, keep the commandments. He said to him, which ones? Jesus said, you shall not murder, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not steal, you shall not bear false witness, honor your mother and your father, honor your father and your mother, and you shall love your neighbor as yourself. Verse 20, the young man said to him, all these things I have kept from my youth. What do I still lack? Jesus said to him, if you want to be perfect, go sell what you have and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. and come follow me. Verse 22, but when the young man heard that saying, he went away sorrowful, for he had great possessions. Verse 23, then Jesus said to his disciples, here we go, assuredly I say to you, that it is hard for a rich man to enter the kingdom of heaven. And again I say to you, it is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich man to enter the kingdom of God. When his disciples heard it, they were greatly astonished, saying, who then can be saved? Verse 26, final verse. But Jesus looked at them and said to them, with men, this is impossible. But with God, all things are possible. Amen?
Amen.
I said, we're going to challenge you today. Amen? Amen? The subject today is the possibilities in God are endless. The possibilities in God are endless. The key is in God. Amen? We've already prayed. We already invoked the Spirit of the Lord to come in. And so we are set to get into the teaching of His Word. So let us begin. As we look in these verses, please note the man's question to be saved. What good thing, what singular thing or act that I need to be saved? He says, Jesus responded and said, listen, he says, well, you know, keep the last six commandments, because that's what these commandments are. The first four are all about God. Remember, thou shalt love thy Lord thy God, and thou shalt not worship any other God, basically. He says, you know, remember the Sabbath, keep it holy. He says, thou shalt not use the Lord's name in vain, and thou shalt not make any graven images of anything like God or anything likeness, whether in heaven or on the earth or in below the earth or in the seas. He says, but those are all about God, all about the holiness of God. So he says, well, if you want to know what it means and how you're going to enter into heaven, he says, keep the last six, which is all about us. Amen? It's all about what we're going to do now, how we're going to live. And this man says, hey, I've kept all these. But look at what he says. Let's go back here again. Look at what he says in verse 16. Now, behold, one came and said to him, good teacher, but here it is, what good thing shall I do apart from the commandments? I've already done that. I've kept the Ten Commandments. I'm good there. So what else can I do to be saved? Amen? Now, it's interesting because this man was unpleasantly surprised, amen, with Jesus' response. Jesus says in verse 20 and 22, he says, the young man said to him, I've kept these things, all these things I have kept from my youth. What do I still lack? All right? Jesus says, oh, okay, if you want to be perfect, or in other words, if you want to be complete, which is what perfect means in this text, if you want to be complete, go sell your possessions, amen, and give to the poor. Sell what you have and give to the poor. And then you'll have treasure in heaven. And then come follow me. How many know that Jesus knows the heart of man? Remember Nicodemus came to Jesus by night and he said to Jesus, he says, Lord, I know you are a man from God because nobody can do the things that you have done. Basically pumping Jesus up. And Jesus says, no, Nicodemus, that's not why you're here. You want to know what it means to be born again. You're here to try to figure out how to get into heaven. Even though you didn't ask me, I know that's what's in your heart. Jesus looked at this man and said, okay, you want to play the game? All right, what things must I do to be saved? Keep the commandments. Because he knows what's coming. The man, he knows, God knows our hearts. The man says, I've kept them. Jesus says, oh, you want to be complete. You want to be perfect. You want to be able to get into the kingdom. Let me tell you what you need to do then. Because I know there's something stopping you from being in or being able to enter in. And that one thing that's stopping you is you're rich. And your money is really more powerful than I am in your mind. Come on now. He said, oh, if you want to be perfect, go sell your possessions and give it away. And this, the Bible said, this man, look, verse 22, but when the man, young man heard it, or heard that saying, he went away sorrowful, for he had great possessions. Amen?
Amen.
Now, it's interesting because when Jesus says to him, you know, I know what's in your heart. Go sell your stuff. He already knew where this man stood. But the man had to see what's in him. That's like us. We might can put on a big facade in front of folks and people all over the world, but God knows who we are, and God knows our weaknesses, and God knows what is maybe even hindering us from growing and being more obedient than we should, I mean, than we are. Amen? Mm-hmm. He knows. And so today's teaching is, look, it's not in your power, it's in God's power to transform, to change, to draw. Amen? Because none of us is lost while we're still living in this earthly body until we take our last breath. And wherever you are at that moment, either you're with them or you're not with them. But Jesus goes on and he says, look, verse 23, he says, then Jesus said to his disciples, after this man walked away, he's now going to do a teaching. Assuredly I say to you that it is hard for a rich man to enter the kingdom of heaven. He didn't say it was impossible. You know, you can have money, you can have wealth, but you don't put it above God. You don't put nothing above God. There's one Lord, not money, it's Jesus. Amen?
Amen.
And everything that you have came from the Father of heaven, the Father of lights. Every good and perfect gift, the Bible says, came from the Father of lights. God says, the earth is the Lord's, the world and they that dwell therein. The earth, everything that exists in this earth, God says, I own. Amen? And I give it to whomever I want to give it to. I have mercy on whomever I want to have mercy on because I'm God. So when you look at what you have, you should thank God that and give God praise for blessing you with whatever you have. Amen? Don't take it for granted. Don't think that it was in my skill, it was in my intellect, it was in my ability to have all of this. No, without God, you have nothing. And as fast as it came, it can go. And if you don't believe it, look at Job. Job said, naked I came in this world, naked I leave this world. Blessed be the name of the Lord. When the things that Job had was taken away. Because God blessed him, but then God allowed the adversary to take it away. He didn't interfere with it. He said, you just can't touch Job's soul. And so, look at what he says here. I love this because he goes into verse 24. He says, again and again, I say to you, it is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than a rich man to enter the kingdom of heaven. Really? Wait a minute. A camel passing through the eye of a needle? Now, we understand this is a metaphor. Okay? We understand that, you know, he's not really saying a camel will pass, but a camel can pass through the eye of a needle if God wanted to. See, we're calling it a metaphor because, you know, in our finite minds and our ability to think, how can this be, you know, we're going to come up with the answer that is, it's impossible. But God says, but what's impossible for man is possible for God. And what this message is talking about is the possibilities in God are endless. There is no limit to what God can do. Amen? So, how can a camel pass through the eye of a needle? Amen? I came up now, you know, God can do anything he wants, but I just came up with two scenarios real quick. You know, because God can do anything, and I believe in the possibility that God can do anything. If God can speak over a darkness of a world and cause it to exist, and light and things and mountains and animals and just by speaking, okay? You gonna tell me he can't make a camel go through the eye of a needle? Here's my two scenarios. This is just me, all right? So don't nobody say, "Cole, that's scripted." No, it ain't scripted. But I just, you know, in my imagination, I'll be thinking, how can God do that? Well, one, he can enlarge the needle to be the size big enough for a camel to walk through. Or he can shrink the camel. Amen. I mean, those are just things that I think, because there's nothing impossible for God. You hear me?
Amen.
Or he can have a camel spiritually pass through a spiritual needle.
That's right.
Amen. Mm-hmm. Spiritual, all that means is invisible. Mm-hmm. Okay? So there's a lot of things going on in the unseen, the invisible, that would blow us away if we were able to see. You hear me? Because the possibilities in God are endless. But here's what I want us to do. I want us to see God as he really is. Amen?
Amen?
And as we grow in our faith, we also need to grow in our belief about who God is. So it's like, I want you to turn with me there and look at this. Mark chapter 9. This is where I believe we have a lot of people are. Mark chapter 9, and look at verse, we're going to pick up in verse 20, and we'll read through 24. Mark chapter 9, verse 20, it says, the little H him, was the father had a son who was demon possessed. And so nobody could cast out this demon. So they brought the child to Jesus. And verse 20 says, and when he saw him, the child, immediately the spirit convulsed him. And he fell on the ground and wallowed, foaming at the mouth. The demon that's inside the child is in control. So when the demon shows up in the child and sees Jesus, he's like, oh my goodness, we're in trouble. So he starts rolling around on the ground, foaming at the mouth, doing all this demonic stuff, amen? And then he says, so he asked, Jesus asked the father now, how long has this been happening to him? And the father said, from childhood. And often he has thrown, look, listen to this. And often he, the demon, has thrown him, the child that's possessed, both into the fire and into the water to destroy him. Because the demon is not going to be destroyed. You know what I mean? The demon is a spirit. They can move about this, that, and the other, but a spirit is not going to be destroyed. They're going to live forever either in heaven or in hell. But they're not going anywhere. So the demon is like, I'm going to throw this boy to destroy him in the fire or in the water. And it goes on and says, to destroy him. But here we go. Here's the key word. The father says, but if you can do anything, have compassion on us and help us. Amen. Has anybody been in that place where you just feel like your whole world is turned upside down? There might be illness. There might be poverty. There might be just turmoil all around you. And you just fall on your face and go, God, if there's anything you can do, please intervene on my behalf. Don't ever say, if there's anything you can do. That's the key word right there. If there's anything. No. The possibilities in God are endless. We're going to get into a little bit more of that. But look at what Jesus says. Verse 23. Jesus said to him, if you can believe. Look, okay, you want to throw the if out there. He says, well, if you can believe, all things are possible. If you can believe, comma, all things are possible to him who believes. Come on now. Mm-hmm. He says, all things are possible to him who believes. You heard me talk about our affirmations when we open our mouths. This is the day the Lord has made. This is the day we're going to be victorious. I believe we're going to be victorious because God has backed me up by his word. This is the day I'm going to be fruitful. Not if I can be fruitful or maybe I'm going to be fruitful. No, I will have peace. I use the word will. I will be healthy from the top of our head. See, the terms that we say out of our mouths, do we really believe it or are we saying it just enough because we know that God can do it, but will he do it? Let's keep reading. Look at this. Verse 24, I love the way he puts this out. Immediately the father of the child cried out and said with tears, Lord, I believe help my unbelief. Wait a minute, that's almost like an oxymoron. That's like, I believe, but I don't believe. Or, I want to believe, but I'm not sure if I believe. It's like going back and forth. No. What he's saying is, Lord, I believe because I know you can. I'm not sure, God, you'll do it for me. See, that's where he's like, I believe. That's why we brought the child to you. I don't know whether you're actually going to do it for me. And so when we're talking about the possibilities in God are endless, we got to come up. We got to come up and start believing that whatever I'm going through, whatever I need that is necessary, my God shall supply all my need. Amen? If I get sick, that's a need. If I need finances for something, that's a need. If I need my children to be restored and saved, that's a need. Amen? Y'all hear me?
Amen.
So this father gives us an example of now the challenge is, I believe in you, God. I believe you can, God. Now I need to come up to believe you will, God, for me. This is a challenge. See, it's easy to believe God for a healing of a cold, flu, or maybe even a COVID-19. We can believe God for that kind of healing. Amen? What about cancer? What about those diseases that is so bad that it's like, you've heard, oh, if I get this, I'm a goner. As opposed to, cancer is just another name, just like the flu, just like COVID-19, just like a cold. Amen? There's nothing God can't do. It's a matter of, if you can believe, we just saw it, all things are possible for those who believe. Amen? It's not what you can do, it's what God can do. And this is the challenge I keep talking about. We can believe God for saving our children from the company of even corrupt friends. You know, like they're in the wrong crowd, and Lord, please don't let them get in trouble. Lord, please, you know, move them away. I don't know what you got to do, God, but just move them away from that those people that's influencing my son or daughter to do the wrong thing or to get caught up in the bad thing. Amen? But what about when they turn away from God? What if they need to be saved from the snares of the devil? What about even when they speak against God and Jesus particularly? Can you believe God for the impossibility that says, even with all that, my child's going to be saved? Well, let's look at this. Look at Matthew chapter 12. That's why you heard me say, none of us is lost as long as we got breath in our bodies. Matthew chapter 12, look at verse 31. Amen? Mm-hmm. He says, therefore I say to you, every sin and blasphemy will be forgiven men. But the blasphemy against the Spirit, the Holy Spirit, will not be forgiven men. But look at this. Anyone who speaks a word against the Son of Man, Jesus, it will be forgiven him. But whoever speaks against the Holy Spirit, it will not be forgiven him either in this age or in the age to come. And what he's saying is that, look, even with Jesus, the power is not Jesus. The power is the Holy Spirit. And when you have the power of the Holy Spirit come upon you through Jesus or with Jesus, amen, as they all are God, one God, amen, but they all have different functions. Remember, you heard me talk about that. The Father is the will of God. They all do what God the Father's will is. Not my will, but thy will be done. All right? Jesus is the Word of God. Jesus is, anytime God the Father opens his mouth, it's Jesus. Y'all hear me? Mm-hmm. But the power of God is the Spirit of God. And God says, when I perform my spirit, I mean my power, in this world, whether it's healing, deliverance from demons, or whatever it is, and you take that and say, oh, that's not God, that's the devil, which is what they did here. God said, oh, we have a problem with that. You're not going to give away my glory to anybody other than me. You can speak against Jesus. Because he's the Word. He's not the power. The power is the Holy Spirit. You shall receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you. Not you will receive power when Jesus comes upon you. The power of the Holy Spirit is the function of God. And it is a He. It's not an it. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. It ain't but one God for three functions. That's why we get this triune God. One God for three. Amen. Y'all follow me?
Amen.
And so when we get down to your children and how you, they might be wayward at the moment. They might be going out here doing all kind of stuff like I did and like some of us were doing. Amen. I ended up getting saved. Hallelujah. And some of you all that was out there doing just as bad got saved. How do you think that happened? I would surmise it happened because somebody prayed for me. I know my mom did. I know probably my grandparents did. Amen. But I believe that somebody prays us into salvation. No one can come to the Father. Oh, Jesus said, no one can come to Jesus unless it has been granted by my Father. Granting is a result of a request. Somebody had to pray. And so my question is, I don't care how bad your children might be or going down the wrong path, they could be locked up and done all kind of stuff. The only sin that's not forgiven is the blasphemy of the Holy Spirit. So until that happens, if it ever happens, you pray with the faith of believing that nothing is impossible for God. All my children are going to be saved. All my grandchildren are going to be saved. Amen. My great-grandchildren are going to be saved. All of them. Because we're believing in the impossibility or the impossible. Amen. The possibilities, you hear me say, in God are endless. Jesus showed us exactly who God is when he walked with his disciples. Number one, Jesus said, when you see me, you see the Father. He says, I and my Father are one. He says, when the Holy Spirit came upon Jesus as a dove and remained upon him, Jesus showed out who God really was. What? Healings began to happen. Deliverances began to happen. Mercy and compassion began to happen. And through Jesus, we saw the love of God happen. Amen? And so today I pray we take one more step closer to seeing God as God. Not as man, and being it began to activate our faith to believe God for the impossibilities or the impossible. God is omnipresent. He's everywhere at all times. He is omniscient. Omnipresent. Yeah, he's everywhere at all times. Omniscient. He knows all things, and he's omnipotent, which means he's all powerful. This is the God we serve. This is the God that we sing about when we talk about he's marvelous. Or this is the God we talk about when we say he's an awesome God. Amen? But I love this because God will even show in Numbers. I'm going to try to get there real quick. In Numbers chapter 11, God even asked us, he's like, look, hold up. Obviously, y'all don't know who I am. Amen? If you look at Numbers chapter 23, God says this, and the Lord said to Moses, has the Lord's arm been shortened? He says, now you shall see whether or what I say will happen to you or not. This scripture is in result of the people of Israel who was crying out for food because they were wandering in the desert for 40 years. And somewhere during that time, they were looking for something to eat. So God rained down manna from heaven, which is like a wafer, a sweet wafer that covered the ground, and they were eating wafers, amen? But they were fed. But then they got tired of wafers, and they started complaining again. And they said, look, we would have been better back in Egypt when we had all kind of fish, leeks, cucumbers. They just started reflecting on the things that had them in bondage, by the way. But they were fed. And God is like, wait a minute. I poured water out of a rock. I fed manna. I gave you food from heaven. It just fell down. You didn't have to work at it. You didn't have to do nothing. Now you all are coming to me and crying out about more food, but you're not coming in an honorable way. You're coming to complain. And so God, Moses brings this to the Lord, and the Lord said to Moses, he says, has the Lord's arm been shortened? Like, do you not know? Have you not seen the work that I can do, the power that I have? I can, look, where do you think the manna came from? It never said that he did it with his hand. It just fell. Now he says, okay, they want some meat. I'm going to give them quail. All of a sudden, quail just shows up, covers the ground. They all are now eating meat. But see, God had a problem with how they came to him, because they came not believing in him to supply their need. They came complaining. He said, I'm going to give you what you want, but then I'm going to strike you with a plague. The Bible says, while they were still eating with the quail in their mouth, in their teeth, he struck them with the plague, because they came in a dishonorable way. They didn't see God as the God of impossibilities. They saw him as a God who either is not looking at them, not listening, not caring. But God has shown himself over and over again, I am God. There's nothing I can't do. And we who are people of God have got to come to that next level of believing in the impossibility. You heard me say cancer, because that's one of those sicknesses that people just automatically think is a life sentence of death. Doesn't have to be. Amen? It depends on where you are. And I'm not saying that just because people have exercised their faith and God took them home anyhow, that they didn't have enough faith. Because God knows who we are and when it's time for us to go. But I tell people all the time, until I'm gone home, I'm believing God for the impossibility. If I'm sick, I'm believing God for healing. If I need something in finances, I'm believing God to restore. If I'm praying over my children and grandchildren and great-grandchildren, I'm believing that God is going to deliver. Amen? And that's where we are. So here's what I want to leave you with. We talk about God, the God of impossibilities. So here's for the children of God. Do you believe that God can do it? And I'm going to answer these three questions by saying three simple statements that we're going to adopt in our training today. You notice I said training. Number one, trust in the truth of God's word. Trust in the truth of God's word. Number two, experience brings encouragement. Experience brings encouragement. And number three, let go and let God have his way in you. Number one, trust in the truth of God's words. The Bible says the promises of God are yes and amen. If it's in God's word and he promised, this is what I will do, the answer already is yes and amen. Now, God's word has been tried and tested, amen, and proven to be infallible. Infallible means incapable of making mistakes or errors. So if God's word is infallible, incapable of making mistakes or error, let's look at what 2 Peter says in chapter 1, verse 19 through 21. It reads this way. 2 Peter, chapter 1, verses 19 through 21. It says, and so we have the prophetic word confirmed. That means it's been proven. Prophecy and prophetic means when they spoke it, it hadn't happened yet, but then it happened, which confirmed what they had already spoke. He says, we have the prophetic word confirmed, which you do well to heed as a light that shines in a dark place until the day dawns and the morning star rises in your hearts. Look at verse 20. Knowing this first, that no prophecy or scripture is of any private interpretation. You all might hear me say from time to time, even when you have tools, you know, study Bibles and concordances and theologian books and all these things that man translates to interpret what the scripture means. And those are great tools. Haley's commentary, I use that a lot. James Strong commentary, commentary, I use that a lot. I Google sometimes, but all of that is not God's word. God's word is God's word. So these tools are good to help us, but don't rely on the tools, because you'll find in the study notes, they'll say, some theologians believe this about one scripture. Some theologians on the same scripture believe that. But most theologians believe this. So they give you an idea on what the scripture means, but the best teacher of God, or of his word, is God. The Bible says, you need not anyone teach you. The anointing, the Bible says, teaches you, comparing spiritual things with spiritual things. That's the one that gives you the illumination, the revelation, the light bulb goes off. The truth, or trust in the truth of God's word. If we're going to believe God for the impossibility, we need to believe his word and trust it and hold him to it. God, you said. Every best prayer that you can see in the Bible is when they start recounting, God, I remember you said da 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 da. And God's like, I did say that. Number two, experience brings encouragement. 1 Samuel chapter 17 is a story about David. And there's many other people in the Bible, but David is the one we're going to look at real quick. Chapter 17, verse 32 through 37, it says, and Saul said to David, you are not able to go up against this Philistine, talking about Goliath, to fight with him, for you are a youth, and he is a man of war from his youth. But David said to Saul, your servant used to keep his father's sheep, and when a lion or a bear came and took a lamb out of the flock, I went after it and struck it and delivered the lamb from its mouth. And when it arose against me, I caught it by its beard and struck it and killed it. Verse 36, your servant has killed both the lion and bear, and this uncircumcised Philistine will be like one of them, seeing that he has defied the armies of the living God. David is representing God. And then look at this. Moreover, David said, the Lord who delivered me from the paw of the lion and from the paw of the bear, he will deliver me from the hand of this Philistine. And Saul said to David, go, and the Lord be with you. It wasn't in man's ability or skill or talent to be able to come up against an overwhelming obstacle. And that's what Goliath is. He was an overwhelming obstacle that every one of Saul's army fled every day when they would line up to face the Philistines, and then Goliath would walk out. But David said, what's going on here? And they said, oh, this man named Goliath, he comes out to defy the armies of Saul. The armies of Saul. David says, who is this uncircumcised Philistine that defied the armies of the living God? See, David looked at it, God, they looked at it, Saul. With man, it's impossible. But with God, all things are possible. And David got more encouraged when he came up to now Saul or about to slew Goliath because of his experiences he had when he was out as a shepherd boy and God showed up and showed his power that, look, it's not your ability. Go get my sheep. That's what God said. Go get my sheep. I know it's a bear. I know it's a lion. But it's not you. It's going to be me in you. And through those experiences, David got encouragement. So that every time we go to the next level of our faith, we just reflect back on the last time God showed up in your life. That's what you got to do. Everything you go through, hey, if God delivered me from this, he can deliver me from that. If God can, God will. You hear me? All right. Number three, let go and let God have his way in you. Let's go to Galatians. This is the last one. Galatians chapter 2. Let go and let God have his way in you. And the reason we're saying let go, because we need to understand, again, if it's not in your power, then it's got to be in the power of God to do the impossible. And so here in chapter 2 of Galatians, we're going to read verses 19 through 21. And it reads this way. For, this is the Apostle Paul. For I, through the law, died to the law that I might live to God. You hear me? Mm-hmm. So, Paul being a Pharisee, Paul being zealous for the people of God, I mean for God, but one of the people of God, but at the highest level, he was the chosen because he was a Hebrew of the Hebrews, he was a Jew. Everything, he checked every box that was according to the law, and basically went beyond. He was zealous for the Lord until he realized he was on the wrong side. Amen. And then he met Jesus, and then God showed him who he really was, who God was, and then told Paul, hey, you got it all wrong. And once he got it right, Paul's identity only changed through being on the right side. But his personality never changed. Paul was still Paul. And so here he says, I died through the law so that I can now live to God. But look at this. I have been crucified with Christ. Here's the key words. It is no longer I who live, but I now live in the flesh. No, I'm sorry. But it is no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by what? Faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. I do not set aside the grace of God. For if righteousness comes through the law, then Christ died in vain. Righteousness didn't come through the law. Righteousness comes through faith and grace. Amen? And Paul says, because of the grace of God, I am not setting that aside one bit. Because it was grace who saved me. It was grace who put me in the right place. It is grace who, what righteousness means is being in the right standing with God. Amen? Doing the right things now. Amen? That's why the word right is in the front of righteousness. We are righteous in Christ. Apart from Christ, we are nothing but filthy rags. Amen? But he says, it is not I who live, but it's Christ who lives in me. Everything that I do, every powerful miracle that you see Paul says I do, it's not me. It is God in me. So let go and let God have his way. If you truly never allow God to rule in your heart, it starts somewhere. It's got to start sometime. And if you already have been letting God rule in your heart, then you got to come up. It's time to take it to another level. I know that as long as we are in this fleshly bodies, we still have work to do. We still have, or God says, he who began a good work in you will see it through at the day of Christ, which means until Christ comes back, God is still working in us. That means we still have room for improvement. We still have room to come up to believe in the impossibilities that only God can do. Because with man, it's impossible. But with God, all things are possible. Do you hear me right now? Remember, the possibilities in God are endless. Amen. May the Lord bless you and keep you. Amen.